Thank you very much for that kind of introduction. During the referendum campaign, at a meeting I did in Commonweal, a woman in the audience asked me what would happen if we lost. And I promised her that hundreds of thousands of other people, some of them here today, that we would not disappear. And I look around and I see we have kept our promise. We've kept our promise to everyone that we spoke to in that referendum. And then today we can look into the future. We held our first conference the same time 2 years ago, where we made the left-wing case for independence to show that the movement for independence was vibrant, diverse and broad. I'd sincerely like to thank everyone for attending the third and biggest ever radical independence conference. We can go home today knowing that it won't be the last. We've all worked to build an independence campaign from the bottom up, from the grassroots, which has spoken openly about class inequality, about the desire for a radical redistribution of wealth and power. And I think it was that stuff, it was those things that were crucial in convincing people to vote yes. I think it's important to say that the radical independence campaign belongs to us all. There is no one party and there is no one person that can rule this campaign. It is bigger than all of that. The radical independence campaign belongs to all of us, and all of the ideas which have come from the workshops today need to be taken forward. So we're opening up new ways of getting involved and participating to keep the campaign alive and energetic. And of course, when the campaign was set up, people told us there was no point to that campaign, and that popular support for independence would never rise above 25%. And those same people that told us that went out and for over 700 days told others that if they dared to vote yes, they would lose their jobs, they would lose their homes, their pensions, their livelihoods. And yet 1.6 million still voted yes. An act of ambition, not apprehension. And it was those people, it was the pictures that we saw of the 18th of September. It was the women and men of Craig Miller who were led to the polling station by a piper and a dignified march. It was the elderly man that I met in the borders who'd waited his whole life for that moment, and his only regret was that his wife wasn't around to see it. And it was a young woman in Glasgow who'd just become a mother who saw an opportunity for her child. It was the hundreds and thousands of us who voted in the interests of other people, for our families, for our community, and not the self-interest. Part of a movement that stood up against the odds, against the propaganda machine of media and state, against the scaremongering of the ruling elites, against the influence of international capital. We should be immensely proud of ourselves, because we proved that when we have a vote that actually matters, we'll turn up in our millions to participate in deciding our own futures. And we proved our tenacity. When the entire might of the British establishment was against us, we still had the audacity to believe that we could win. It's in that spirit that right now we are making history. And it said, and Tyler referred to it earlier, that history is written by those who are victorious. And so, who write the history of the 2014 referendum? Our movement is growing every day. People are joining us that we didn't know before, that we didn't know before the 18th of September, and they want to be part of the victory that will inevitably come. The stale, corrupt and tribal politics which has held us back for so long are crumbling. Those who thought they would be guaranteed the right to govern Scotland for good are realising that they have betrayed ordinary people too often. On the 18th of September, it was those who supposedly won at the ballot box who have lost in the long run. If history is written by those who are victorious, it will be our story. With people power, we have shaken the arrogance of the banks, of big business, of the political elites, of the monarchy, and we can continue this success. The movement for independence was the greatest self-education movement in Scotland's history. And the sum of all that knowledge, I think, meeting you went to every article that you read, every person that you spoke to, the sum of accumulating all that knowledge means that it doesn't matter that we weren't born into a scene privileged, and it doesn't matter that we weren't educated at Eton. We now have the knowledge to know we could rule ourselves a damn sight better than any Westminster politician.
Civil disobedience against trying to show that.
and that extends beyond this room and beyond today. Because it's important to go out from here and reach out to the 55% who weren't quite there this time, but who will be part of future victories. And this is crucial because the real balance of power always rests with the people when we stand together. And I'll finish here paraphrasing a great radical campaigner. In our dreams, we've seen another world, a world decidedly more fair than the one in which we live right now. In those dreams, we saw a world where there'd be no need for war, be it economic or military. Because in the world to which we aspire, things like peace, justice and equality are everyday things, not far off concepts. So far, we've been dreaming of this other world, and now we remain convinced that another world is still possible. Our story is not yet concluded. From humble beginnings in only 2 years, and against the will and might of the rich and powerful, we have arrived at this point here today. We were bigger and stronger than ever before, and we have landed, I truly believe, what I think is will prove to be a fatal blow to a political system which shut us out for decades. Another Scotland is still possible. Our eyes are open and our minds are ready. We are closer than we ever have been to winning. We will never go back in our boxes. We are Radical Scotland, and we are here to stay. Yeah.